of IWM, Professor Neela Natarajan. I'm supposed to say some brief words about IWM activities too. So this is IWM. We have a good website here. So IWM, that is stands for Indian Women in Mathematics, is an organization to form a network of women mathematicians in the country. We know all that the number of women in this field is significantly small, and also due to the solitary nature of the work, unlike experiments, so women often feel isolated. So for example, in my department, I am the only woman faculty. So to do this, IWM organizes yearly activities. So two of them are regional workshops and one is annual workshop, so annual meeting. So for two regional workshops, which are held not in so prominent locations of the country, that's a deliberate to reach out women in various parts of the country, especially remote. And since the last year, we also started a workshop for training young women in mathematics. So that runs for a week or so. So they also have a visitors program. So under this program, prominent women mathematicians visit a part of the country, give several lectures in nearby places, and interacts with women who are postgraduate or doing research in mathematics. So this year, due to COVID, most of the activities, the planned ones also were stalled. So however, IWM intends to run a visitor program lecture series now. So this is basically a lecture series under which once a month a prominent established woman mathematician will give a talk, and after the talk there will be discussion related with various issues like career choices, etc., or doing research in mathematics. So that will be open to the public. So today's thing will be conducted by Professor Sachish Srivastava and Professor Amber Habib from. So now today's speaker is going to be Professor Neela Gupta from ISI Kolkata. So she's a young mathematician who earned her fame early in her life. So her first famous work is on Zariski cancellation problem. So this problem dates back to 1970s. So many prominent names are involved in solving this problem, but couldn't push it beyond the case of, say, dimension 2, or Neela will explain what does it mean by dimension 2, or what we call surfaces in geometry. So now she joined the force of these prominent mathematicians, and in 2014 she gave a counterexample to the problem dimension 3 onwards. So she has naturally numerous awards in her pocket. So Bhatnagar Award, Swarna Jayanti Fellowship, Birla Prize, Young Scientist INSA Medal, etc., etc. So I can't complete the list, it's too long. And so I request her to present some of her work here now. So.
Professor Vijayakrishnan for giving this long introduction. But I'm very happy to be a part of Indian Women Mathematics. I hope I am audible.
No, Neela, can you talk loud? I can't hear.
Am I audible now? Is it okay?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So this is a platform where many women mathematicians come together and share their work, and maybe it's a good thing to happen. But in future, I would hope that there is no such distinctions and we all work together without any distinctions. I wish that there is no such need of having a separate platform for us, and we will have a equal opportunity to work with everybody on the earth without any distinction. This work, which I am going to share, is a joint work with my student, Prof. Saurabh Sen. I will not go in much detail of the proofs, but I will explain the problem with a little bit of history behind it. And since there will be people from various backgrounds, need not be from algebra, I would say that my aim is to deliver some kind of philosophy behind mathematics, means how one should progress and how does mathematics grow on its own and how does problems keep on coming. And so I'm sure this is open for many people to come in. Anybody, since an online platform, many people can come and enter and listen to this talk. So we begin with.
Yeah, so mute.
Yeah. If there is any problem, any doubt, please interrupt and ask me. I am unable to see the participants and viewers, so feel free to disturb me and ask questions. Okay, so let us fix some notations. All my rings are commutative rings with unity. Most of the time, K will denote a field and R the field of real numbers, C the field of complex numbers, and B is a finitely generated K algebra. Means almost often it's an integral domain. So these are some very basic things I will start assuming with. And this notation will be quite often used for integral domains. R contained in the ring A, both R and A are integral domains. The notation A is equal to R square bracket N. This will mean that A is a polynomial ring in N variables over R. That is, you can write A over R by N many more elements. Means you can adjoin N many more elements and which are algebraically independent over R, and A is generated over R by N many elements. So this is the basic notation. Let me first explain what was the cancellation problem. Okay, what happened? So cancellation problem. So for simplicity, I am assuming that B is an affine domain. See, the version of the cancellation problem asks, there is some problem with this moment. I think making me a host is a problem. I can't share, keep on. Yeah. So let A be a finitely generated K algebra, and the cancellation problem asks whether if you, the polynomial ring in one variable over A, if suppose it is isomorphic to a polynomial ring in one variable over B, does this necessarily imply that A is isomorphic to B? That means you have given two rings A and B. After adjoining one more variable, say the polynomial ring over A, say AX, and one more variable to B, the polynomial BY, suppose these two rings are same. Can we infer that the coefficient rings are same? So this is a very fundamental and basic open problem. This is a one of the version of the cancellation problem. And it was probably a very long, it's a very old problem. And we will call a ring B does not satisfy the cancellation property if you can find a K algebra A such that the polynomial ring in one variable over A is isomorphic to B1, but A is not isomorphic to B. Then we say that this ring B is does not satisfy the cancellation property. So this talk is about a study of one such example of a ring B which does not satisfy the cancellation property. So these are some known results. So as usual, as I said, K is a field and B is an affine domain. And the question is, if A1 is isomorphic to B1, does this necessarily imply A is isomorphic to B? The answer was known. It was proved by Abhyankar, Ikin and Heinzer. It's a very long, interesting paper. One should read it. This proves that for any one-dimensional ring B, the answer is yes. The dimension of the ring B is 1. A1 is isomorphic to B1 will imply A is isomorphic to B. Soon there was a counterexample. This counterexample was due to Hoekstra over the field of real numbers, and the dimension of the ring was 4. We will discuss this example in the next slide. But very soon, Miyanishi Sugi and Fujita together, they solved this very important fundamental problem, proving that the polynomial ring in two variables over a field K, over a field of characteristic 0, has the cancellation property. If A1 is isomorphic to B1, then A is isomorphic to B. So this was a very difficult problem. It took a long time to solve this. After Abhyankar, Ikin and Heinzer for dimension 1, this problem remained open for say some 19 years, and many work was behind this. It's just not one paper. There are very series of papers behind proving the cancellation problem property of the polynomial ring K2. And soon this Soon this problem was proved over a field of positive characteristic by Peter Russell, and the answers turned out to be yes, even over a field of perfect field, but we could prove it for any field K. This was just an extension. We proved it along with Professor Bhattwadekar in 2015. So, but this was all about the positive solutions. And what about negative? So this, the first counterexample to the cancellation problem, this generalized cancellation problem, was for over the field of real numbers where the dimension of the ring was 4. In 1989, Danielski constructed some two-dimensional surfaces over the field of complex numbers, proving that the cancellation property does not extend to dimension 2. That means we cannot have a generalization of the Abhyankar-Ikin-Heinzer result over dimension 2. So this was Danielski surfaces. These surfaces we will discuss in detail. And to cut the story short, I think whenever people say want to admit, my screen stops working. So recently, some 4 or 5 years back, we proved that this cancellation property for the polynomial ring K2 does not extend to dimension 3 in positive characteristic, and in higher dimension in positive characteristic for any integer n greater than or equal to 3. This problem is open in for the polynomial ring case in characteristic 0. It's a very difficult, interesting problem. Still, if people want to try, they can try. It's very interesting. Going to be a very important problem in the history of affine algebraic geometry. Now I want to talk about the cancellation property of polynomial rings. I will stick to this Danielski surfaces and this counter examples of Hochsters. So what was Hochster's example? So this was our problem, the polynomial ring in A1, isomorphic to B1. Does this necessarily imply A is isomorphic to B? So this is a two-dimensional surface. Basically, it's a sphere, regular sphere over the field of real numbers. Real is very important here. And these are some modules map from C3 to C, and P is the kernel of this map. Essentially, this will give rise to a short exact sequence P to C3 to C, and B is a symmetric algebra over P. So what is B here? B is nothing but the tangent bundle over the real sphere. Geometrically, this B represents the tangent bundle over the real sphere, and it can be proved topologically that this ring B is, this tangent bundle over the real sphere is not free, means it's not rectif-, what I say, this vector bundle is not free, so it's not C2, but if adjoining one more variable, it's isomorphic to C3. So it's a conormal bundle. If you add one, it becomes a C3, but it's a B itself is not C2. So this proof requires a little bit of topology. So this was the first example. And moment you replace this ring R by complex number, this becomes free. So it may, it appeared for a long time that, okay, maybe real numbers is something special where you cannot have this cancellation property. Maybe because it's not algebraically closed, that may be a problem. Next, we had this example of Asanuma. Asanuma constructed this ring polynomial, not polynomial, this three-dimensional ring in dimension 3 over the field of a positive characteristic. This characteristic of this field K is P, which is positive. And these are some integers which are depending on this fact that P to the power E does not divide SP and SP does not divide PE. So the Asanuma constructed this ring for any integer M, but I proved it for my result stands for M greater than 1 only. So Asanuma proved that this ring B is stably isomorphic to a polynomial ring in 4 variables over the field K. But we proved that this ring B is not a isomorphic to a polynomial ring in 3 variables. So this was the first counterexample of the polynomial cancellation problem to the positive characteristic. And but this soon I generalized this Asanuma's ring to this n-dimensional ring. which is a slight generalization of isonomous ring, and I proved that this ring B is stably isomorphic to a polynomial ring in m plus 3 variables, but P is not isomorphic to polynomial ring in m plus 2 variables. Now, let's come to this Danielski surface, which is a very interesting surface. Historically, what we have seen is that two-dimensional surfaces, polynomial rings, were proved to be cancellative. So first, we had an affirmative answer for polynomial rings KXY, both in positive characteristic and characteristic zero by Miyanishi, Fuji, Sujita, and Russell. So they were satisfying the cancellation property. Suddenly, in 1989, Danielski came up with this example. This is a very simple looking surface defined over the complex numbers, and with only one restrictions. These restrictions were this PZ has distinct roots. So algebraically, geometrically, if you want to see, this means that it should be equivalent to the fact that this ring BN is a regular ring. If you want to assume BN is regular, the condition would be that PZ has distinct root. And this PZ, I am assuming this degree of PZ is at least 2. So degree of PZ is at least 2. Then what Danielski proved is, so we can see this surfaces, there are parameters, this integer n, which we can see is depending on, so as you vary this integer, so n equal to 1, you will get one surface, n equal to 2, you will get a different surface. So what Danielski proved is B1, if m is equal to 1 and n is equal to 2, they are stably isomorphic, but itself they are not isomorphic. That is, B1 is not isomorphic to B2. But Fieser in 1994 generalized this Danielski examples and proved that for any integer n and m with n not equal to m, these two surfaces are stably isomorphic, but they are itself are not isomorphic. After this, there have been several studies on these Danielski surfaces by Makalimanov, Fizer, Polini, Dublos. Many people have studied Danielski surfaces, studying their automorphism groups, isomorphism classes. There are some generalization of Danielski surfaces and many others. And they have turned out to be very interesting and useful tools for many studies of algebraic geometry in the commutative algebra. With my student, he suddenly thought of studying these kind of surfaces. That is, in Danielski surfaces, we had only one equation, but this is an embedding in A4 with two equations and with some restrictions. So we wanted it to be a counterexample to the cancellation problem. So for that, we had some restrictions on this. So we can see this Danielski surface, this PZ is independent of X, but we generalized it. We put PXZ and QXYZ, two different equations. And with the restrictions like this, PXZ should be a monic polynomial in Z, QXYZ a monic polynomial in Y. Further, let R be this degree of PXZ and S be the degree of QXYZ. And then we can see that this surface BTE, there are many variables like D, E, R, and S. These are going to be useful in the study of classification of double Danielski surfaces. So we call B a double Danielski surface if these integers R and S are greater than or equal to 2. We just observe one fact that if the integer either of R is 1 or S is 1, this ring BDE is nothing but the Danielski surface. We can reduce it to the Danielski surface. But even otherwise, it's not apparently clear that can it be a Danielski surface? Is there any family of, is there any member of Danielski surface which is same to the double Danielski surface or a classification kind of thing? So our aim was to study this kind of surfaces in detail, and we obtained very interesting results, like So we have obtained a complete classification of isomorphism classes of double Danielski surfaces. So this is our terminology. We called it double Danielski because of two equations which we are using here. So let me call this B1 and B2. So for two integers I equal to 1 and 2, let these two be two surfaces. So this B1 and B2, what are the variables here? These integers di, ei, the polynomials pi and qr. So if each of these things are variable here, so let B1 and B2 be two double Danielski surfaces. Then we obtained that suppose these two surfaces are isomorphic, then the following conditions should be satisfied. What are those conditions? All these parameters, D1, E1, R1, and S1 should be same as D2, E2, R2, and S2. So all these parameters should be same. And not only that, we would be able to find some constants, lambda and gamma, and delta, a polynomial in Kx, and a polynomial f in two variables x and z, and a polynomial g in x, y, z, such that these equations has to be satisfied. So this may look a bit cumbersome, but these are very naturally obtained things which we obtained, miss. So it's maybe, miss, I will give a simpler version of this isomorphism class in the next class. Not only that, we proved the converse is also true. If both these conditions 1 and 2 is satisfied, then B1 is isomorphic to B2, and we have obtained an explicit isomorphism between B1 and B2. So that isomorphism will be given by this. So if the conditions 1 and 2 is satisfied, then you can define a map, which is a well-defined map from B2 to B1 given by this, which is an isomorphism. A simplified version is, when I assume that this polynomials P and Q are independent of X, this theorem looks a bit, little bit neater. And basically these integers di, ei, ri, si, I call them d, e, r, and s because they have to be equal. And these two equations have come out to be this form. So this P2, this is a translation of Z, will come out to be like this, and Q2 will come out like this. So this is the crux of the matter. This was the main theorem in the paper, and out of which other corollaries were discovered. So what was the, how do we obtain this result? Means how was this isomorphism class obtained? So the main ingredient in the proof was the application of G action, group actions. So group actions of the additive group K plus. So GA is nothing but the additive group K plus. And so it's an algebraically, it means, exponential map on a ring is a ring homomorphism from the ring A to AU, satisfying the following two axioms, which are basically the two axioms of a group action, namely this composition map from A to AU to AU to A. AU to A is the projection map sending U to zero, evaluation map. This composition must be identity on A. And secondly, if we write phi v as the same exponential map, just replacing the variable U by V, and phi v is the extension sending U to U by identity, then this composition phi v composed phi U should be phi U, V plus U, which is same as U plus V. So if we have a little bit of knowledge of geometry, then these two actions are nothing but the two actions of the group actions of the additive group K plus on the ring, on the variety of the spec of the ring A. But if we don't want to get into all this, this algebra is sufficient to know what is an exponential map. And the ring of invariant, that is all those elements in the ring A for which phi of A is just A, is called the ring of phi invariants. So apparently this is just a set, but one can check that this collection of elements will be a subring of A, and that is called the ring of five invariants of it, and is denoted by AFR. For example, just a very simple example I am giving you. Look at the polynomial ring Kx and define then map phi u from Kx to Kxu by the K-algebra homomorphism defined by sending x to x plus u. And the constants are going to constant, x is going to x plus u, and extend it algebraically. Then phi is an exponential map on Kx. You can check both these axioms are satisfied. And what is the ring of invariant in this case? Any guesses? Yeah. The ring of invariant is nothing but the constants. Only the constant functions are preserved by phi because x is changed to x plus u. An exponential map phi is called to be non-trivial if the ring of invariant is a proper subring of A. Otherwise, if you send phi to be just identity map, then that is always an exponential map. But if A phi is a proper subring of A, we say phi to be a non-trivial ring homomorphism. Let exponential of A denote the set of all exponential maps of A. The Michaelmann invariant of A is an invariant which was defined by Michaelmann. He called it affine invariant or AK invariant. And this invariant had turned out to be very useful in the study of affine algebraic geometry. In fact, cracking many open problems. The one which I know is this solution which led to the solution of the linearization problem in affine algebraic geometry. So this, it was named after the AK invariant when later called to be Michaelmann invariant. This invariant is defined to be the subring of A, which is given by the intersection of the ring of invariants A phi, where phi varies over all exponential maps of A. So what is the beauty of this invariant? So this is an invariant of the ring A. That means given any automorphism of the ring A, the Michaelmann invariant will be preserved. That is, the Michaelmann invariant will be sent to itself. So this turned out to be a very useful invariant. For example, in general, it's very difficult to compute the Michaelmann invariant because you see, one has to know what are all exponential maps. But sometimes it's not necessary to know what are all exponential maps. It may be one can prove it without knowing all the exponential map. For example, if we look at the polynomial ring Kn, one can very easily see this Michaelmann invariant of the polynomial ring Kn is nothing but the constants. So for a proof, we see that if you take A to the polynomial ring Xn up to Xn and phi I from A to Au with a K-algebra homomorphism defined by phi I of Xj to xj plus delta ij u, where 1 less than equal to I less than equal to n. Basically, I am having n many exponential maps, phi 1, phi 2, phi n, where phi 1 is sending x1 to x1 plus u and rest of the variables to be constant. So this delta ij is this Kronecker delta. And then we keep on varying phi 1, phi 2, phi n. So in case of a phi I, what is the ring of invariant? The ring of invariant is all but except the ith coordinate. Every coordinate is present in the ring of invariant. And if you look at the intersection of all these invariants where I from 1 to n, then we get that the Michaelmann invariant of the polynomial ring is K. So if we look at the intersection of all this, I equal to 1 to n, then we prove this. So this was sometimes what I say is we need not know what are all exponential maps of polynomial ring. In fact, this is an open problem, very difficult, challenging problem in mathematics to describe all the exponential maps. But in this case, knowing some of the exponential maps may help us to compute what is the Michaelmann invariant. So the Michaelmann invariant of this ring, double Danielski surface. So BDE is our double Danielski surface. So what we have done, we have first computed the Michaelmann invariant of these rings because these are very useful invariant. So before computing that, we had to prove a very important lemma that these rings are integral domains. Next, we proved that under certain conditions, so conditions are there are some restrictions. So for double DNSK surfaces, we are assuming R is greater than or equal to 2 and S is greater than or equal to 2. Even otherwise, in few other cases where S is equal to 1 or R is equal to 1, we could prove that the Meckelmann invariant is the subring KX, where X is the image of capital X in BDE. So as we have seen that in the case of polynomial ring KN, the Meckelmann invariant is constant, but it turned out that in the case of double DNSK surfaces, these are slightly more than constants. And therefore, but then what about the DNSK surface, which was studied earlier? So is there any intersection between DNSK surface and double DNSK surfaces? The answer is no. Our family, there is no intersection. So if BD is a double DNSK surface and A is a DNSK surface, then under no circumstances, these are going to be isomorphic. Next, we deduced the automorphism groups of the double DNSK surface from the isomorphism classes, basically. So this, using the fact that this Meckelmann invariant of double DNSK surfaces is the subring Kx. So we proved that if alpha is an automorphism of a double DNSK surface, then alpha of the polynomial ring Kxz is Kxz. Alpha of X will be preserved, and there are some other conditions. This looks a bit technical, but if you start working with it, we may start appreciating the result. Not only that, we proved the converse also. So what we obtained is that if alpha is an endomorphism of the double DNSK surface satisfying just 1 and 2, then alpha must be an automorphism of the ring BDE. And we also proved the stable isomorphism results. What is that? So now we are coming to the cancellation problem. So this was our double DNSK surface with the restrictions that these are monic in Z, this is monic in Y, and this degree is R, this degree is S. So I'm just writing it down as a polynomial in Z and this as a polynomial in Y. Now let me define P prime XZ. So it's basically the partial derivative with respect to Z if you are in characteristic zero. Otherwise, it's just a formal expression. As I said, this result is over any field independent of the characteristic. So this is a formal derivative. We can take it as a formal derivative. Otherwise, it's nothing but the partial derivative with respect to Z, and Q prime XYZ is a partial derivative with respect to Y. So with these notations, let me now state our result. So if this P0Z and P prime 0Z are co-maximal, and P0Z, Q0YZ, and Q prime 0YZ, they are co-maximal, then we proved that two such surfaces are stably isomorphic. So D, E, D, E plus 1. So moment you vary for any integer E and you extend it to E plus 1 or N plus 1 or N plus 1, E plus 2, and you can keep on doing it. So they are all stably isomorphic. Now just recall what we have proved earlier. So say if P prime, Q prime, 0Z, they're as before, thus these rings. But if E and E plus 1 are not same, certainly they are never same, these two rings are not isomorphic, because for isomorphism, these two parameters should match, which is not matching. So they provide a counterexamples to the cancellation problem. Thus, these double DNSK surfaces are new family of counterexamples to the cancellation problem. Now, after defining all these things, the next object was there are many difficult problems remaining. Say, for instance, what would happen if we vary our integers d, and say d plus 1? Are they stably isomorphic like this? The answer, we don't know. There are many other problems one can investigate, like is these restrictions really necessary? Can we avoid this kind of restrictions? Because for not isomorphism, we don't need this, but for stable isomorphism, we are crucially using these facts. And many other questions one can think, like what would be the generalization of Asanuma's threefold with two equations? So, or say the computation of the Michaelis invariant of BD cross A1. One can keep on asking questions, and I hope in future we'll be having an answer to these questions. Next, what we studied is the studies the local important derivations. So local important derivation is the characteristic zero version of GA actions, the group actions, which is exponential maps. So if we are in characteristic zero, exponential map is nothing but a local important derivation. So what is a local important derivation? A derivation of a ring A is a linear map satisfying the Leibniz rule, and it is called to be a local important if for every integer A, you can find an integer NA such that this integer N depending on A such that DN A is zero. So when, as I said, this order field of characteristic zero, local important derivation is same as an exponential maps, and conversely. And in a subsequent paper, we have also described how will a local important derivation of an exponential of a double Dynasky surface will look like. And this is the complete classification of all the exponential or the local important derivation of a double Dynasky surfaces. I will stop my lecture by this, because after this there are proofs, and I would like to avoid the general audience with this technical proofs. Thank you for the invitation.
Thank you, Nina.
So, are there any questions?
If you have questions, please unmute and ask. Yeah,
open your mic and can ask the questions.
Yes, thanks for this talk. I have two questions. Question number one.
Can you please introduce yourself? Sorry.
I am Mahesh Rao from Fiji.
Okay.
So at the beginning, she used dimension 4. Of course, she referred commutative algebra. But can we use for non-commutative quaternion systems?
Can we use non-commutative
quaternions?
Non-commutative cancellation.
Quaternions.
I didn't get.
Hamilton's quaternions. He's talking about non-commutative in that sense.
Quaternions.
Yeah.
I'm not aware of that, but recently I have come across many papers by Zhang, where they have studied by of cancellation problems for non-commutative rings, and. Basically, the generalization of Abhyankar-Ikenhauser, there are problems. Dimension one, because dimension one non-commutative is same as the polynomial ring, but still there are very difficulty in general problems.
Yeah. You are taking fourth degree polynomial, which is always obviously commutative, but I'm referring quaternions, which has non-commutativity property.
Yeah, so non-commutative, that's what I'm saying, that there have been some results on that.
Okay. My second question that you have been talking about in terms of polynomials, can we be able to apply this kind of theory for elliptic curves?
What?
Elliptic curves.
Elliptic curves.
Yeah.
So elliptic curves are again like varieties, right? So.
Yeah.
Yes. Why not? Means cross A1, but I suppose for elliptic curves. See, polynomial curves, the example are, say, polynomials, these are contractible. So what about elliptic curves? Are they contractible? See, something which is topologically not correct, we shouldn't expect that to be correct in algebra.
So they have asymptotic behavior. Of course, polynomials have a linearity.
Yeah, so topologically means A1 is contractible. So what about elliptic curves? Are they contractible? No. So there itself, the problem will fail, maybe. Miss, answer will be affirmative.
I am not familiar with the topology.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. I think, oh no, it won't work a metric space.
They are on genus 1, so they can't be.
They can't. So they cannot cross A1. If you want to say X cross Y, then both of them at least have, one of them should be at least contractible. Otherwise, this problem will not make sense. The answer would be affirmative.
Okay, because so you discussed about the group action, all these. So that's the reason I asked. You discussed about the group action.
So group actions, they're used to solve the problems, but it was not inside the question. There are tools.
Okay. Right. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
So are there any other questions?
Yeah. Hello.
Can you introduce yourself, please? We can't see that.
Please. Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, now we can. Nina, can you hear her? Hear you?
Yeah, this is Salil. And my question is there any known similarity? Does it have any known similarity with Lloyd-Shapley value? Shapley value.
What?
Shapley value in game theory.
I have no idea. No clue.
Okay.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah.
I have a general question regarding mathematics. So should I ask?
Can you introduce yourself first?
I'm Ritik. I'm in class 11th right now.
Yeah, please carry on.
Yeah, so my question is like the mathematicians like Newton, Euler or Gauss, they did their work in a lot of fields, but now we are seeing that a lot of specialization is taking place, or we can say over specialization probably. So is it possible for today's mathematician to be like those people like Newton, Euler or Gauss working in different fields?
I can say, Miss, one can read all physics, chemistry, biology in class 10, but why can't they continue for throughout their life? But syllabus keeps on increasing, right? So is about for other branches of mathematics. So few people like Newton, Gauss, of course, I won't say that they were, syllabus was not huge for them, but it was still huge, but they were genius. Even in current scenario, you will find many people who are good at various branches of mathematics. At least they have knowledge about many of branches of the mathematics. They have been able to use and apply them. For instance, some branches of mathematics like say in harmonic analysis or say probability theory or number theory, there have been intersections. They have to be expert in many of the fields, and they have been, they have, if you can manage, nothing like that. I'm not saying it's impossible. If you want, you can do it. All the best.
So, well, there are still problems in mathematics which are called $1 million problems. So if you solve them, you'll get a lot of money. So
one doesn't know which field of mathematics will be applicable there. For instance, one problem in my area is the Jacobian problem, or say Riemann hypothesis. One doesn't know, means in fact, I know about Jacobian conjecture. You can formulate this problem in many branches of mathematics.
Okay, so it's still possible.
Yeah, it's still possible to make a lot of money doing mathematics. So any other question? Okay, so Nina, I have one question. You said Makar-Limanov invariant is very important invariant. So what kind of properties does it show for a ring?
So first of all, this invariant is a subring of the ring.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
The important property is that if you have any automorphism of the ring, this subring will go to itself.
Yeah.
So in some sense, you are putting a restriction on the automorphism. See, for instance, polynomial ring, the Makar-Limanov invariant turned out to be K.
K, yeah.
So if you try to distinguish whether a ring is not a polynomial ring, happened with the case of Russell Corus threefold, some very important threefold in the F-algebraic geometry. So there was a certain problem, people were unable to distinguish it from the polynomial ring. Because it was topologically C3, and only that many algebraic properties were similar, like projective models like C.
I can't hear you. Neena, I can't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
So this Russell Corus threefold was almost like a polynomial ring. And no known invariant could
distinguish. It's contractible, you are saying.
Can you hear now?
Yeah. I'm asking, is it contractible, you're saying, that Russell thing?
So Russell threefold was contractible. I am saying topologically it was C3.
Okay.
Topologically C3, but not algebraically also very, like it was a regular ring, it was a unique factorization domain, projective models are free, there's a subring dominant map from C, it can be embedded inside C3 and many other things. Like similar such properties we have for K2, it will be K2 by a theorem of AN. But by dimension 3, this was unable to distinguish. And Makarlimanov, he proved that the Makarlimanov invariant of this ring, Russell Corus threefold, is not constant, not C, and therefore it cannot be C3. So in some sense, if it is not, it turned out to be very useful, because this was something which was which helped Russell and Corus to solve the linearization problem for C3. And later, what I did for this Asanuma's threefold. Asanuma's threefold also, I was studying some kind of invariant which was similar to Makarlimanov invariant, that is called Dirksen invariant. It was named after Dirksen. Makarlimanov invariant is the intersection of all the ring of invariant. Dirksen invariant is just ring generated by all the ring of invariant. In the case of polynomial ring, the Dirksen invariant should be the whole ring. So what I proved for the Asanuma's threefold was the Dirksen invariant is a subring, proper subring. In some sense, it's a useful tool to handle. Use if we can compute, it's very useful.
But can you compute it?
Yes.
No, generally, is it easy to compute or not difficult to compute? I mean,
some techniques work, sometimes it doesn't work, but there's no such algorithm, because computing such invariant, you need to know various kind of exponential maps. And all exponential maps or all Lucas potent derivation is not.
And this Daniel Lusky's surface, you can take this polynomial PZ with a distinct root of any degree.
Any degree. If you take degree 1, then it's nothing but
So in particular, you can take the surface to be like a graded ring also, homogeneous ring.
Yes, but if you take a graded ring, it will not be a regular ring. So for it to have distinct roots, it has to be non-graded ring.
So in characteristic 0, what is the expectation for A3, like polynomial ring of 3 variables? This is my last question, Can you hear me?
No, I cannot understand the question. What is the...
So in characteristic 0, so if you take a dimension 3 case, so what is the expectation? They think the cancellation problem is correct or not?
In my opinion, it should be cancellative, but then there is a double dynasty, this Russell Corus threefold is still there. So Russell Corus threefold, one knows it's not a polynomial ring, but one doesn't know whether it is stably not a polynomial ring. Cross A1, this is still an open question.
But generally, you don't use any characteristic P technique in your proof, right?
No idea.
Okay.
In fact, to be frank, means this the first paper where I proved this Asanuma's threefold is not cancellative. That is little messy. Little messiness involves a lot of technical calculations.
but there's another paper which appeared in Composition.
Mm-hmm.
So that was a full theory. Means, there's no technique. There's no computation. It's theory. It's pure mathematics. As I would say, this sophisticated mathematics. Think of sophisticated things. So there it has come out very beautifully that why cancellation was proved, why it was not proved in some sense. So why positive characteristic has played a role. So that is essentially because in positive characteristic, you have a non-trivial embedding of a line in A2. But in characteristic zero, it does not have a non-trivial embedding in A2. So if I just can show you this asynonymous threefold is there in my slide. Yeah. So this polynomial z equals t plus t plus t super st. So this is a non-trivial embedding of a line in K2.
Mm-hmm.
But such a line does not exist in characteristic.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the everything behind the cancellation. So if you can give me a non-trivial line in K2, I will give you a counterexample in K3.
Uh-huh.
So that is the theory which we offer.
So I think there are questions, but people can open their mic and ask the questions. They are writing on the chat box.
There is a
question, but this is going into the general questions. So are we done with the technical questions? If anybody has any...
No, this some people had a mathematical question also.
Yes, ma'am.
Somebody is Saroj. So can you open your mic and ask question?
Yes, good
Saroj,
evening.
Saroj, ma'am.
Good evening.
Anyway, so this person's question, let me read out then. Can the degree of PZ, I think Danilowski's surface perhaps the person is asking, can the degree of PZ be larger than N?
No, N is any integer, right? N is 1, 2, anything. Let me show the Danilowski surface once again. So in the Danilowski surface, N is any integer, right? It can be any integer. And PZ is any polynomial, preferably degree greater than 2. Greater than or equal to 2. If PZ has degree 1, it is polynomial in K2. So it's a non-constant polynomial with at least 2 distinct roots. N is any integer. N can be 1, 2, 3, 5, anything. And degree of PZ is greater than or equal to 2. That is, there is a mess. I should have written it down.
So your BN depends. I mean, BN could be different for different PZ. That's what.
Yeah. And if you varying your N, you can get different rings. And
so, what do you mean is that if you change your
PN, can you be a bit louder? I can't hear you.
Change your PN.
Riddhi, we can't hear you.
Oh, sorry. I'll write on chat.
No, now we can hear you. Now we can hear you.
If you change PZ, then your BN will change. So your BN is dependent on PZ, right?
Yes, yes. It's certainly dependent on PZ. So this isomorphism, I meant it for P fix. That's why I didn't change my P.
Yeah, okay.
So there is some comment by Professor Ajit Iqbal Singh. Maybe she can open her mic and talk.
I was just saying that the word derivation comes from derivative. The properties, it is a linear operator and it satisfies Leibniz rule. Vitaly Milman and H. Kronisch concentrated just on Leibniz rule. And they came up with this characterization. Either it is derivative or it is derivative plus the map which takes a function f to the new function g, where gx is fx log of mod fx, and it is related to entropy. Is that could people hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I just said because there are people, you know, working with derivatives, and derivation word is coming from there. So for non-differentiable functions, here is a derivation. And the information theory people use entropy so very much. They add minus xi, log mod xi, log xi, they take positive numbers, and 0 log 0 is taken to be 0. So they use it, and this is a characterization provided by Vitaly Milman and H. Koenig. That's all I said, but talk was wonderful, and it was very clear, very nice. Thank you, Nina.
Thank you, ma'am.
And all the best.
So, are there any questions on YouTube also?
There is
I don't know how to handle that, so
no, there is a general question, so that's we can once we finish the technical part we can go to the general
okay question. so are there any further mathematical questions? If none, then we can open the forum for the discussion.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes,
I thank you all for listening to the talk. I wanted it to be a bit mathematical, so that if it is going to be on YouTube, people should not say that women mathematics, they don't discuss mathematics.
So, thank you. We can all unmute for a moment and give a clapping for Nina.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so Nina, please don't leave. We have other questions for you.
Yeah. Okay. So I think Ambar, Habib, and Sachi will take over.
No,
so.
With the contingency in laser, we know.
Yeah, see, I can see one question on YouTube which I can immediately ask. So it is from Mansi Mahapatra. Nina, her question is, what were your struggles in becoming a woman mathematician? Did being a woman hinder or help or neither? Neither help nor hinder.
It's neither. Well, I don't know whether it helped or not, but I think it's neither. Anyway, being a child, I never had a problem being a woman. So brought up by two brothers, so was almost similar to them. So working with them, whatever they were doing, I was also doing the same thing. So no hindrance as of now.
Yeah.
So somebody has asked, can you show a glimpse of the proof?
Glimpse of the proof? That's not there in the slide.
I don't know.
But I can, these papers are online, one can see it, or this is a paper already published. It's on double Danieski surface, if we can just search. I think they are also on our math archive. If they're interested, they can look at it. Proof is technical, I would say. So it goes pages by pages, so with a lot of calculations.
So Dr. Anjusu had a question.
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening.
Hello. Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay. Ma'am, I just wish to know some real-life application of group theory, ring theory, or in day-to-day life.
So for instance, any codes and computers, these are used some way or the other.
Ma'am, your voice is very low, basically, no? Your voice is low.
Computers also, they are used, right?
Nina, your voice is very low. It's not audible.
Yes, ma'am. Now it's okay. Again, very low.
I can't help it, miss. I'm shouting. Hello? Now it's okay?
No,
yeah, it's
ma'am.
Better. It's yes. Better. It's better. It's
so
better.
I'm saying, group theory has been used in various branches, like in computers, definitely there's been used in security also, security functions. Physics also, they have been used by groups and rings. So,
ma'am, I just want to know.
Anju,
what
Anju, you can see the chat window. People are responding to your question.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Okay, thank you, ma'am. Thank you. I will go through all these now.
Sure.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Are there more questions?
No, thank you, ma'am.
So very likely, I think next month the talk will be something related with group theory, I suppose.
Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you.
Yes. So Sachi Rambar, we can start a discussion. Where?
So I can stop sharing?
Yeah.
Yes.
But it would be good if you can participate in the discussion.
Yeah, it's okay. I think myself.
Yeah.
Yeah, Sachi Amber, are you there?
Yeah, hello.
Do you want any more questions that I can find? On YouTube, there was that Mansi's query. And generally, I mean, there are just comments saying how nice the talk was. Okay, but so that's wonderful, but I don't see any questions as such.
Yeah, there is some other comment also, which is from Deependranath Mahato.
Okay.
So this is application of groups, it continues.
So I think we don't have any more discussions. Questions to discuss. So maybe Neela, you can give a vote of thanks.
Yeah. So thank you, Neela, for this wonderful talk. And I think IWM has been missing its event because of the pandemic. So we hope that things will settle down soon and we will be able to have our regular programs, which is aimed at motivating people to do mathematics. However, the virtual series was a decision by the EC, and I think it is really wonderful. It has been a good participation over here. So I can tell you that throughout the talk, there were more than 150 participants, all YouTube and this thing put together. This was an experiment by us. Now we will probably go to in a more formal account, IWM account, for doing these talks and so on. We would really like to thank you for starting off our sessions, and we hope to continue this series with one talk in a month, and hope that you will also from a different point of view, there were people, when I had sent this invitation, there were people who were asking whether we have a membership for IWM and so on. So we are not a society, so we don't have really a membership for IW, but anybody who is interested in activities can write to us. And we have around 14 EC members, so you could get in touch with any one of us, and we will be happy to make you a part of organizing any of these events. Yeah, and with that, I would like to thank you all and stay safe. Riddhi, you want to add something? Riddhi wants to add something. Riddhi, do you want to add something? You are speaking, but you are not audible.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah.
So I just want to add that our activities are largely funded by National Board for Higher Mathematics, DAE, Government of India, and we are also supported by Committee for Women in Mathematics, IMU, International Mathematical Union. And wherever we hold activities, the host institutions also support us, and our activities work and are successful because of all the support. And of course, the IWM committee members do work very hard. They take up responsibilities of various activities. I just want to add.
You're again not audible, Riddhi. Riddhi.
I can't hear.
Oh, thank you, Nina, for starting this series with a bang.
Thank you.
Thanks, Nina. Yeah.
Okay, then bye all.
Thank you, Riddhi.
Yeah, Professor Indira, you want to speak something?
No, I just wanted to thank you people. Thank you. Information that I get.
I also see Dhona Thapa from Nepal. She's attending this talk. She's an old friend.
There are many people from Nepal.
Yeah. We are five, I think. Kavita, me, Sharmila, Nilam, Saraswati, and some of them are watching from YouTube. I think so. Yeah. And we are very happy, especially me individually too, because many of the friends from India, Geeta, Riddhi, Neela, Maua, Ankita, I think Amber also maybe, because we had in communication in email, though yeah. I would not join the IWM annual conference in 2018 and 19,
yes.
But my friends were there consecutive years of 18 and 19. So we are very grateful to the IWM and the executive committee of IWM, especially Neela, Riddhi, Geeta, and so many of friends. Actually, today's talk was very interesting by Nina, and this is very important to us joining such type of webinar and talk given by the women mathematician. So we are also following the step from IWM also and the mathematician from India. So we are very happy. These 2 years, 18 and 19, I was very in difficult situation due to my health. So I think nowadays, now I will be join my job as my friends know me. And actually Women of Nepal in Mathematical Sciences, WONIMS, is also delighted to invite some women mathematicians to have some type of talk like this, young women as well as the eminent professor from Indian University. So I would like to request from this forum, from this Zoom cloud, to my friends, to the professors from different universities of India, especially Riddhi, Neela, and Geeta, because I know them very well, and we are here in 2014 and 2017, and somehow we can talk in email too, and we can share your email to our women group in Nepal. So if time permits, if we have some similar interest in the field of mathematics, so definitely we'll have some talk from your side too, because we are very few women in Nepal who are doing research nowadays. Our friends are very empowered to have some research work in mathematics, like in biomath and some partial differential equations. And our friends of five of our friends are in now PhD enrollment. So we'll talk about more on such a program, and I'll discuss with my friends Neela, Riddhi, and Geeta. Of course, with Amber, sir also, Amber Habib, because I know the University where he belongs to. So thank you for giving me this opportunity to talk to with you and acquainted with you all in this participants of 100 people from the India and Nepal. I think my friends are also listening from Kathmandu, not from the out of Kathmandu. I think you are all safe and nice to see you all with happy moods, happy talk. And really, I am so happy with you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, organizer, IWM, and my friends, and the presentator, Nina. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dana. Does anybody want to say something? Anyone wants to say something? Please unmute and speak.
Well begun is half done.
Thank you, ma'am.
But we have to go to the set of natural numbers. Thank you. All
thank
the
you,
best.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
So we'll close now, Neela?
Yeah, I think we should close now. Thanks, everybody. And bye.
Thank you. Best wishes to IWM. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Take care.
Bye.
Take care.
Bye.
You also stay safe.
Bye.
On the
website,
on the YouTube
link.
Bye, Riddhi.
Bye. If we get recording, then we should put on the YouTube link.
No, it's already there in the YouTube, already but it's there. Going to remain there. Oh, it's going to remain there.
Thank you.
We can give a link from our website.
It's already there. Link is already there.